And I'm here to guide you through the daily activities, events, and the ins and outs of what occurs on the street. So sit back, relax, enjoy your cup of coffee, purchase one with some popcorn bucks, and enjoy a word from the metaverse.
Cafe Jason Cabanas, Black Sun Bar, giving you the latest on what is happening on the street and what is affecting our world here in the metaverse. So today we're going to be talking about open source, what it is, some various places you can go to, and how open source is helping decentralize the internet, has helped build the internet, is enabling for a lot of different, very unique and interesting programs and interfaces that people utilize constantly on a daily basis without even knowing it that is open source. For example, one of the biggest projects out there are Linux, which is an OS operating system. One of them is Linux kernels, is actually the backbone for the Android devices that people have devices throughout the world. Another open source project that generated a lot of people is Bitcoin. So the open source project that is changing the way people think of money in the financial system. And it has spun up a lot of other open source projects, much like Linux has spun up different nodes or different types of flavors of OSs. It has gone into the servers, like the Linux server, instead of just using the desktop system, again with the backbone of Android, the system for phones, tablets, things of that nature. All this is open source. And so we'll talk about what exactly open source is and the different projects that are out there. But before we get into that, let's talk a little bit about, some news. So Belarus police arrest over 400 protesters standing on a beat. This is from ABC News by Euros Komananu. Police in Belarus cracked down hard Saturday on opposition protesters who tried to hold a forbidden demonstration in the capital of Belarus is Minsk. The human rights group said that more than 400 people were arrested and many were beaten. Demonstrators had hoped to build on a rising wave of defiance of the former Soviet Republic's authoritarian government led by President Alexander Lukashenko, who has ruled since 1994. Belarus is literally like the last dictatorship of Europe. Is one of the last holdovers of the old, Soviet style government, and there's been many efforts and many different groups of unseat Alexander Lukashenko. There have been many efforts over the years to put pressure on the Belarus government, put pressure on Alexander Lukashenko, either by the Russians or the European Union, UN, US government, various governments, sanctions, different types of ways to kind of either soften the Belarus government to more democratic process or to kind of curtail some of the harsh tactics that this particular government has used. None of them have been very effective in unseating the current dictator of Belarus or really doing any significant reforms. There have been a lot of surface reforms within Belarus, but there have not been any really deep-seated hard or reforms within the government itself. So, continuing on with the article, about 700 people tried to march Saturday along this main avenue, but were blocked by a cordon of riot police wielding clubs and holding shields. After a standoff, the rest began. There were beaten participants dragging women by the hair to buses. I was able to run to a nearby courtyard, a demonstrator Alexander Ponova said. Tatiana Wabalko of the human rights group Avensa told the Associated Press that more than 400 people were arrested, saying many of the arrests were beaten and are in need of medical help. Police declined to comment on the arrests or the beatings. Among those who were arrested were about 20 journalists, according to the Belarusian Journalists Association. And skipping along here. In the days preceding Saturday's demonstration, more than 100 opposition supporters were sentenced to jail terms of 3 to 15 days. Vezina reported before the raid that the prominent opposition figure, Vladimir Nikolaev, reportedly was pulled off a train by police overnight while traveling to Minsk. The anti-government protesters Protests also attracted hundreds of people Saturday in Bess and Gordon, two of the large cities. No arrests were there, were immediately reported. Belarus has seen an unusually persistent wave of protests over the past 2 months against Lukashenko, who recently claimed that a fifth column of foreign supporters and agitators were trying to bring him down. Saturday's demonstrators shouted slogans including shame and basta, enough, and deployed the red and white flag as the opposition symbol. The flag was first used by the short-lived independent Belarusian People's Republic in 1918, and again after the country's independence from the Soviet Union, but was replaced in 1995 after Lukashenko gained power. In his 23 years as president, Lukashenko has stifled dissent and free media and claimed much of the Soviet-style command economy. The protests this year initially focused on the unpopular anti-parasite law that calls for a $250 tax on anyone who works less than 6 months a year but doesn't assume the state labor exchange. But the protests have broadened into general dissatisfaction with his rule, which some critics have characterized as Europe's last dictatorship. And other protests that are happening. Russian protests. Opposition leader Navalny under sentence arrested. Russia's main opposition leader, Alexei Navalny, has been arrested as an anti-corruption protest he organized in the capital, Moscow. Thousands of people joined rallies nationwide calling for the resignation of Prime Minister Dmitry Medvedev over corruption allegations. At least 500 other protesters were detained in the capital across the country. Most of the marches were organized without official permission. TV pictures show demonstrators chanting down with Russian President Vladimir Putin, Russia without Putin, and Russia with Putin as a thief. Correspondents say the marches appear to be the biggest since anti-government demonstrations in 2011 and 12. Alex Navalny was detained as he arrived to join the rally in central Moscow. Protesters then tried to prevent a police van from taking him away. In a tweet after his detention, he urged fellow protesters to continue the demonstrations. Guys, I'm fine. No need to fight to get me out. Walk along Tverskaya, Moscow's main street. Our topic of the day is the fight against corruption, he said in Russian. He later said that police stormed the office of his foundation and detained his staff who were broadcasting the protests live. Demonstrations were also held in St. Petersburg, Volostovka, Novosibirsk, Tomsk, and several other cities where arrests have been reported. The U.S. has condemned the detention of hundreds of peaceful protesters throughout Russia. Detaining peaceful protesters, human rights observers, and journalists is an affront to core democratic values, Acting State Department spokesman Mark Toner said. Yet the U.S. was troubled by Mr. Navalny's arrest. There has also been arrest of journalists. Some of the protests have been kind of a little violent with beating up of protesters during arrests. Local media reports suggest authorities pressure students not to attend in some cities. Exams were scheduled on Sunday. They're trying to kind of curtail the amount of people that are going to come out. Alex Navalny announced his intention to run for president in 2018 against Vladimir Putin, but he's barred from doing so after being found guilty in a case he said was political side. He said on his website that protests were planned in 99 cities, but that in 72 of them, authorities did not get in. Protests that occurred last month, Romanian flag recreated by over 50,000 protesters in Budapest. At 9 p.m. sharp on Sunday evening, more than 50,000 people that had ever attended a protest in Victoria Square in front of the government building opened the flashlights of their phones and placed on top of their devices a sheet of paper that was colored in blue, yellow, or red, depending on their location in the square. This comes from Project Fascinate, written by, just as a newsroom. This is said to be operates. The other article from Russia's from ABC News. The people recreated the Romanian flag in the 13th consecutive day of protests against the center-left government led by Zoran Grindean, calling for unity in the fight against corruption. Several thousand people continue to demonstrate in other large Romanian cities as the political tensions in the country remain elevated. Meanwhile, around 1,000 people are calling for the resignation of President Klaus Onas in a separate protest that was also taking place in Bucharest near the Cochin Palace. The people had gathered near the government building were also calling for the resignation of the head of the Chamber of Deputies, Levin Dardenne, and Ebbett, and the other President Senate, Helen Huskas. Who was put on trial in a corruption case on Friday. Dragnea got a suspended jail sentence last year and is currently tried in a separate corruption case involving his former wife. Dragnea is the head of the Social Democratic Party, while Trinica is the co-chair of the Alliance of the Liberals and Democrats, both parties from the ruling coalition that controls the governor. In addition to the PSB-ALDE alliance holds a majority of the parliament. The protests have continued throughout the weekend, although the government repealed last week the controversial amendment to the criminal code, which initially triggered massive street protests. However, the interim Minister of Justice, Anna Birchall, said that she will restart the discussion on the topic with representatives of the legal community. The parliament is expected to vote soon on the government ordinance decision that cancels the previous ordinance, which included the amendments to the criminal code that partially decriminalized abuse in office. So basically what they were basically doing was it was legalizing bribery and corruption, it was going to be okay, and the people were not for it. Since the start of the political crisis, two ministers from the Guinean government have resigned. Florine Dion, who was the Minister of Entrepreneurship, and Florine Ardochi, the Minister of Justice. Oh, that's interesting. Both named that. Sure, it's probably Florine is like John. So Romania had protests going, and it's still kind of intermittent over there, concerning about their government and the corruption happening in that country. And kind of around the world of protesting, South Korea has had a series of protests beginning last year concerning the corruption of its president, Park Geun-hye, over corruption. This article is from CNN by Paula Hancock and Eugene McGrady. South Korea has been plunged into a period of political uncertainty after President Park Geun-hye was forced out of office by a corruption scandal. The country's constitutional court held a parliamentary vote to impeach Park over allegations of corruption and colonialism. She became the first democratically elected leader to be forcibly removed. Three people have died in chaotic protests in the capital of Seoul. Seoul police spokesman Kim Dong-min told CNN Saturday that one poster died in the local hospital where he was being treated, and two others were confirmed dead by firefighters overseeing emergency medical services on the scene of the protests. Dozens of people were injured. Thousands of demonstrators have a unanimous decision by eight judges were read out during down a live broadcast of Grip the Nation. The decision brings the career of South Korea's first female president to an inglorious end. It also comes at the pivotal moment for the region as North Korea ramps up its nuclear weapon testing program. Here are the main developments. Stripped of her immunity, Park is liable to prosecution. A snap presidential election will be held within 60 days. Turmoil comes as tensions rise with North Korea and China. An acting president warns North Korea may take advantage of the uncertainty. The scandal also entangles the acting head of Samsung, who I believe has been arrested. Park was brought down by a corruption scandal that has dominated South Korea politics for months. The president was accused of being unduly influenced by her long-term friend and advisor, Cho Sun-sil, who was on trial of abuse of power and fraud. The Constitutional Court agreed with the accusation that Park had abused her authority in helping Cho raise donations from companies for foundations she had set up. We announced the decision as unanimous among all judges, and we dismissed the defendant, President Park, said Justice Lee Myung-min. An election for Park's replacement will be held within 60 days. An ad hoc cabinet meeting will soon be held, the government official proceeded. With Park's ruling conservatives looking out of favor, it seems likely the country will turn to the left-wing opposition, which has signaled it will likely to pursue a policy of engagement with the North. The left-wing government would also place into question the continued deployment in South Korea of a U.S. missile defense system, which is bitterly opposed by China. Liberal candidate Moon Jae-in of the opposition Democratic United Party currently leads the opinion polls. Moon was defeated narrowly by Park in 2012. Chaos in the street. Soon after the court ruling, acting president Hong Kyo-yeon appealed for unity, acknowledging that the conflict had polarized the nation. South Koreans on opposing sides saw each other as enemies, he said in a televised address, and now is the time, however, for acceptance, he said. As the court decision was delivered, a group of 100 Park supporters tried to break through the police lines near the court, and a number fell and were injured. We lost our liberty, we lost our freedom, one protest was CNN. Anti-park demonstrators also took the streets, some crying tears of joy and pumping fists in celebration. As applause rang out from the crowd, many had camped out in the streets overnight in the cold. And the article continues about the state of Korea, the security concerns concerning a weakened Korean government, as a window, if you will, that North Korea will take advantage of, which it has when it started launching some missile testing within the last, you know, during this year, this period of year, if you will, because it was going on in Korea, as well as the transition of the U.S. government as well. Last bit of protest, if you will. Brit exit protest. Thousands march in London to unite for Europe as it's happened. EU supporters take the capital streets to demonstrate against Britain's departure from the Union. Nick Clegg wraps up the rally with a blistering speech and almost persuades Alistair Campbell to forget the coalition. Thank you for standing for the principles of openness, tolerance, and pluralism. In a European Union, of course, is not perfect, but there's so much protecting us from tyranny, he says to the crowd. Like many of you, I was proudly saddened by the outcome of the referendum, but that the sadness is given way to the perpetual sense of anger about the choices that Theresa May and the government has taken since. It was a choice to pull out from the customs unions, it was a choice to embark on that demeaning bout of transatlantic opaqueness. Clegg explains that he accused the Prime Minister of threatening to turn our country into a bargain-basic cowboy economy. And that is it for the day. Campbell receives a polite round of applause as he sends the crowd home with an exorbitant keep fighting to keep Britain in Europe. So the reason why I'm bringing up these protests is that a number of them have been particularly like they occurred just after the U.S. election in the States with the Women's March. They have been organized through the usage of internet, through social media, through Facebook groupings, from group meetings to end-to-end messaging services, to organize and to gather on Twitter and to reach out to people and discuss and talk and signal to one another to come out and do these protests. These tools were never available, you know, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. It took a tremendous amount of effort to do that. Now you have things that are almost like flash mobs or flash protests, if you will. But while those were initially maybe potent at first, when you have these very organic flash where, hey, come out and protest at the Capitol, this is the reason why, now they're getting extremely well organized, where they say, hey, bring some water, bring a flashlight, bring a jacket, if you have extra food, bring it, bring this and bring that, and come at this designated time. They've been very organized. For example, Romania, the flag protest. You know, bring a piece of paper that's like this, and if you are at this point within the square, you just put this piece of paper on and you've been able to really make the flag. You can convey this very complicated scenario to people in the most simplified manner with through video chat or through tweeting or through text or through a Facebook group and sharing in mass to gather people. And it's becoming extremely more effective, which is one of the reasons why you are seeing all these backdoors or efforts to create backdoors, the end-to-end encryption. We talked about Peter Thiel, about Plantera, all this data mining to track and to bag and tag people to suppress. Here in the States, they're trying to make it almost illegal to protest through these different kinds of very Darkarian, very bad laws, draconian, however that word is said, laws to stifle and prevent people from protesting. Because if you're going to face a prison sentence, if you're going to face jail, if you're going to have to pay, because I believe it was the state of Arizona, because then a riot may have popped up, or the police say a riot had gone off, there was damage done by somebody else, but because you were an organizer or a participant, now you're responsible for the damage of someone else's activities, which has never really had it ever occurred before. you know, things are changing because they're becoming effective. It's because of protests that the South Korean president is no longer there. It's because of the protests that people are leaving the remaining government. It's because of protests that people are dying in Russia. You know, there's all these different types of, you know, people kind of joke about it, but, you know, journalists and activists and opposition leaders are either disappearing, dying, or being imprisoned in Russia because of protests, because of dissent within these governments. And it's just something to keep an eye on to see which ones are effective, which ones are not, how to counter or help or aid, whether it's getting, you know, server access, whether it's helping, you know, people set up VPNs or conveying information, or when they're cut off, finding ways for those individuals to reach information, enable that access for them, to keep an eye on that, because it's necessary for an ever-evolving, growing human society that we should be able to protest and challenge the current infrastructures that we as individuals reside in, or other individuals reside in support of that, of those efforts. In some additional news, federal agents ask domestic flight passengers to show IDs and search for immigration order deportable. This is again about all about the banning of immigration, particularly of Muslim extraction, as well as just there are reports that this is happening in New York, Boston, subway stations, buses, specifically targeting people as they're picking up their children from school, areas where there's likely to be a congregation of immigrants, specifically not just any immigrants, but those of Hispanic descent or brown people just in general are being targeted. So, the U.S. Customs and Border Protection confirmed Thursday that their agents requested to see identification of domestic flight passengers landing at New York Airport Wednesday night as they searched for an immigrant registry with a deportation order to leave the United States. This article is by Wesley Lowry. According to the agency, two CBP agents asked passengers who had been on Delta Flight 1583 from San Francisco to show their identification while deplaning after landing at JFK Airport about 8 p.m. Wednesday. The search was conducted at the request of Immigration and Customs Enforcement. The CBC said in a statement, but the persons they were speaking were not on the flight. Kind of skipping around. A spokesman for Delta did not respond to requests for comment. Jordan Wells, a staff attorney with the New York Civil Liberties Union, said the law enforcement officials sometimes board airplanes to apprehend a suspect or fugitive. He said it would be unusual for authorities to wait outside an arriving airplane to ask for identification for each passenger. Occasionally, they'll pull someone off the flight, or all our officers will come on and make an arrest. It's much more surgical than setting up a dragnet. This is what's so alarming about the way this was played out. Yeah, this is very, you know, I've spoken to people that have worked in the airline industry in the past, and they've talked about this, particularly because of Homeland Security and heightened awareness, if you will, the things that they have to deal with, and what it was like before 9/11 for those who have worked in the airline industry before that, and after, and the different economic stuff that's going on. And, you know, when dealing, you know, I remember having this conversation, you know, talking about movies and how they depict, you know, particular jobs and stuff like that. I mean, I remember having this conversation about, you know, people being arrested and taken by police officers and stuff like that. And they say that it does happen. They say typically they'll do transportation or something like that. But for most of the part, a lot of that does occur, like, go through the U.S. Marshal Services, and, you know, very occasionally, very rarely, would someone be transported on public transportation like that, or at least their experience, through the airlines like that. And when it's done, there's all sorts of different protocols and things of that nature. But most importantly, they've stated that most of the time, it's just that their experience has been grabbing people on the plane. They were after, like, when they're deplaning and they're coming, passengers, and then securing stuff, and so that law enforcement could come and grab somebody that they needed, whether they were a fugitive or they were a elderly passenger or something of that nature. So for something like this to happen, it's just unseemly, you know. It's just an increasing practice of what a college student uses artificial intelligence to build a multi-million-dollar legal research firm. This is from Forbes by Daniel Fisher. This again is about software, you know, software robots, if you will, replacing people. And we had spoken about it. The Facebook, I think, on the news, perhaps, about how a law firm had utilized a computer program to scan through like 300K worth of documents, legal documents that would take months for their legal team to go through. This software program did it in minutes to gather the useful information. So here we are. Lawyers spend years in school learning how to shift through millions of cases looking for the exact language that will help their clients win. What if a computer could do it for them? It's not the kind of question many lawyers could dignify with an answer, but Johan Albaile is a lawyer and as a budding computer scientist studying at the University of Toronto a couple years ago, the idea made perfect sense. He and his colleagues combined it with IBM Watson's artificial intelligence platform to co-found Ross Intelligence, a multi-million dollar legal research firm that has lined up a global law giant Denton as a backer, and customers along with other prominent customers including Baker Halstern and Latinum Watkins. His efforts also earned him in place on this year's Forbes 30 Under 30 list. Albaghin and his team first drew their attention to big corporate law firms after they built a prototype legal assistant they called Ross that won second place in the IBM Watson's cognitive computing competition of 2015. John R. Fernandez, chief innovation officer at Denton's, flew to Toronto to meet the team and soon arranged for Denton's to finance a fledgling firm through his Next Law Labs unit in Palo Alto. Taking on the incumbents in the space is a big challenge, Fernandez says, but increasing availability of legal documents online combined with artificial intelligence makes it possible to create a different way of doing research. Not just researching for sources, but asking a question you want a first analytical answer to. The rapid progression from an undergraduate idea to a multi-million dollar business in 1 to 2 years might seem surprising to some, but not to all of you. And the story continues. So, AIs are now, you know, this is used to be the task of paralegals, junior law candidates. Now, things are going to get more precise or more nuanced, if you will. They're going to be more precision when it comes to researching answers for the law to go through all these different types of cases. I imagine through time, it's probably going to take time, it's probably going to take decades, there will be less lawyers necessary. People are not going to be able to do this themselves, you know, do all the research for themselves and do the filing. It can all be done through software, much in the sense that TurboTax and H&R Block and other tax software programs are available for both small and very complex tax filings. This could eventually become the case. I think there's only going to be a lot of use cases, and you have to think about the legal ramifications of a software glitch. If a lawyer messes up, they can get sued for malpractice, lose their law license. What happens with a software program? But as of right now, this is the beginning of the wave of the future, if you will. And then we'll eventually revisit this, but Stanford University's 100-year study on artificial intelligence 2016 report has published. This is written by from TechHuman, written by Rudy D. Wally. As a society, we are underinvesting resources and research on the societal implications of AI technologies. Private and public dollars should be directed towards interdisciplinary teams capable of analyzing AI from multiple angles. The 100-year study on artificial intelligence, launched in the fall of 2014, is a long-term investigation of the field of artificial intelligence and influence on people, their communities, and society. It's considered that science, engineering, and deployment of AI enable computing systems. As its core activity, the standing committee that oversees the 100-year study forms a study panel every 5 years to assess the current state of the AI. The study panel reviews AI's progress in the years following the immediate prior report, envisioned the potential advances that lie ahead, and described the technical and societal challenges and opportunities these advances raise, including such areas as ethics, economics, and the design of systems, the compatibility with human cognition. The overreaching purpose of the 100-year study periodic expert review is to provide a collected and connected set of reflections about AI and its influences as the field advances. The studies are expected to develop synthesis and assessment that proves expert-informed guidance for the direction in AI research, development, and system designs, as well as programs and policies to help ensure that these systems broadly benefit individuals and society. So eventually we'll go over this and talk about this and go over the report itself. It's just very fascinating, and not surprised that Stanford has done this, that we are now doing research on the research of AI. Uber is doomed. I'm sure you've heard of Deleted Uber, some of the machinations of its CEO. A lot has happened to Uber within the last, I would say, 6 months that has not been to its benefit, from the sexual harassment complaints and investigations, to the changing of the guard, if you will, as people from the top are leaving the company, and the fact that Travis Kanak is possibly changing positions, if you will, or giving a little bit more oversight, and in general that Uber is not quite making the money that it should be. So this article is by Ryan Felton. If there's one quote that sums up the ethos of Uber, it might be this cut from the company's firebrand CEO, Travis Kanak: stand by your principles and be comfortable with confrontation. So few people are, and so when people with the red tape come, it becomes a negotiation. But after a month marked by one disaster after another, it's hard to see how Uber's defiant confrontational attitude hasn't blown up in its face. And those disasters mask one key critical issue. Uber is doomed because it can't actually make money. And that's been the big problem, particularly when these companies are using the principles, or at least wearing the clothes of a sharing economy, and they're not generating or fostering any real money. So they wear the clothes of the sharing economy, but they don't practice the ethos. They're posers, if you will. They may have taken pieces of the concept of the sharing economy, but have just rammed capitalism, or the bad aspects of capitalism, through it. And totally missed the point of the whole concept of the sharing economy, about sharing resources, being distributed, decentralized, allowing for a greater, you know, freedom, of economic freedom for people, but also not having a negative impact on society around them, whether it be local, regional, or just worldwide, if you will, whether it be for the environment or economically, if you will, having a better understanding or a better impact in society in general is the concept of the sharing economy. One of the earliest prototypes, if you will, of the sharing economy was Couchsurfer. It was in the early aughts, where people would meet up and just sleep on somebody's couch, surf around a couch. This was something before Airbnb came into existence. It was Couchsurfer. And it wasn't really a money-making business or concept. It was just hooking people up through a web page at the time and connecting one another and just having a good time, a good adventure, if you will, meeting new people, but also being able to have a place to crash for a period of time if you're visiting, you know, Belarus or Moscow, if you will, or Toledo, you know, being able to stay somewhere for a night or two nights and then moving on, and then doing the same kind when you get back to Santa Fe for somebody. That was the whole idea. And it didn't really make money for the owner or anything like that. It was a good user experience, it was a good experience and proven ground for the concept of that sharing economy can happen. You see this with bike sharing programs. You see all sorts of different sharing programs out there that you kind of use that kind of ethos. And it's okay to make money. There's a way to go about it, and it doesn't seem that Uber is capable of going about making money. It's just the cost, really. It's just, it costs a lot to drive. It costs a lot for gas, paying people, marketing, the upkeep for the app, all sorts of the legalese, if you will, all sorts of things factor into it. So after a discombobulated 2016, which Uber burned through more than $2 billion, amid findings that the ride fares only cover roughly 40% of the ride, with the remainder subsided by venture capitalists, it's hard to imagine Cadillac could take the company public at a stunning current valuation of nearly $70 billion. And now, in the past few weeks alone, Uber has been accused of having a workplace that fosters a culture of misogyny, accused of stealing from Google the blueprints of a successful self-driving system, and lost 200,000 customers over its ties to President Donald Trump, and now has responded to a taxi driver boycott. Yet, even with those factors that are removed, it's become more evident that Uber will collapse on its own. Barring a drastic shift in the company's business, an impossible rollout of self-driving car fleets across the U.S., an increase in fares by threefold, or a complete monopolization of the taxi and ride-hailing market, Uber's lifeline is shrinking. Its business model will collapse if one court case, and there are many, goes against it, or perhaps more pressing, if it simply runs out of cash. That Calvert quote about the confrontation that many may be innocuous as a random soundbite, but is a representative of the ride-hailing giant's mythology since its founding in 2009, a perpetual resistance to regulatory oversight, a belief that ultimately an unfettered market is the key to prosperity. And it's just not a case. It's just, I know a lot of these guys, these libertarians, believe this belief, but if you have an unfettered market and you're trying to create one, if you will, unregulated, unsanctioned, free-for-all, if you will, you're going to go up against market competition. They do that with Lyft and other ride-sharing services. But it just, fundamentally, there's certain economic principles that just don't work. You have to, like, literally change the entire economic structure for something like this to happen, and it's just not the case. And the fact that they're going up against all these regulations and all these different types of lawsuits, and more importantly, the fact that they couldn't get into China. If they got into China, they'd be okay. But they couldn't get into China. So they lost a lot of capital because of that. At first glance, it seems that Calix's libertarian ideas have paid off. Most recently valued at a reported $69 billion, Uber has captured a majority of the ground transportation market and flipped the taxi industry, a sector Klanik once famously and silently referred to as the big taxi cartel, in which it was a cartel on its head. His philosophy mirrors the mindset of one of his favorite authors, the laissez-faire Ayn Rand. In 2012, Calix proffered that the Uber battle against the government regulation is an uncanny resemblance to the Randian philosophy, a billionaire fighting the system unveiling. It's a good story for those who find truth in Atlas Shrugged, which I personally don't. Uber's long has set skeptics and has not innovated to paint Count 40 as the boogeyman of Silicon Valley whose unseemly savants exits in the vast supply. But curious amount of the company's 8-year history falls on Count's lap. It's his baby after all, a startup founded on a seemingly nothing more than a vague idea without much regard for the workforce to make it possible, or even a clear idea of what business model it actually wants to pursue. Uber has jumped from one idea to the next. Uber X, Uber Eats, autonomous cars, and now flying cars of all things. Instead of focusing on being a good taxi company for the digital age, it's spent all sorts of money on self-driving cars in China and now India. Oh, I forgot they couldn't get into India. And now the company just so much reflects the megalomania of Travis Kalanick and whatever he thinks he's doing. The difference between, I would think, some of the other ride-sharing companies and Uber was, like, Lyft, and I completely skipped some of what the other one is. They did really focus on Zipcar, here we go, on being the best taxi type of company, the best ride-sharing company. And Uber decided to be everything and anything to everyone. It would also, the impact of Uber's death would probably be as much of a rebuke of Kalanick's vision of running on a scatterbrained dream, not so much a solid business model and philosophy that you can muster. It'd also be devastating for some of the livelihood of 11,000 employees across the world rests on panic's decision to submit to that philosophy, which at its core is a ruthless way of doing business. At the very least, drivers in the pre-Uber market could earn a decent living. Conversely, for example, Uber drivers take advantage of the new vehicle solution pilot program Boston, renting cars by hour through Zipcar, will earn less than the Massachusetts minimum wage. How inventive. And so, yeah, they have a contractor problem because they don't treat their drivers as employees. They rent out cars to their drivers, so their drivers are kind of, in essence, you know, giving their money. It's becoming like the company town type of thing, where the coal miner owns, like, the means of people are earning a living, the grocery store, the doctor, everything is a one company town. Uber is becoming that for a lot of people, unfortunately. Plus, he had that big blowout with the driver who confronted him about the price changes and things of that nature. And the article continues on forward. It's a pretty long read, but I think Uber is going to probably be a company that's going to lose some value. Someone's probably going to pick it up and break it up, if you will, into much smaller pieces, but I don't see Uber lasting very long versus Airbnb, which I don't agree a lot with a lot of his practices. Actually did focus in on being a better hotel than hotels, if you will. And it had a stronger partnership with the people that let out his homes or their rooms versus what Uber did with the treating of the drivers. And now in our last bit of news, this comes from off of Medium by Chris Montanaro of Pirate.London. Private messages stolen from Alphabay's world's largest dark market. Alphabay support announced today, which was January 22nd, that a large number of private messages and user information were stolen from the system by a financially motivated attacker by the handle Cypher 777. Such messages typically include drug shipping addresses, personal identifiable information, and general buyer-vendor correspondence around stolen data and drug inquiries. The attacker posted screenshots and production with the proof of the compromise. This is not the first time this has happened. In April 2016, a similar vulnerability in that API led to 13,000 messages being stolen by a miscreant. The legal and privacy impact of the breach was never quantified. As the world's largest darknet market since 2015, and thus the largest target for law enforcement hackers, Alphabay is notable for having a comprehensive privacy policy published in May of 2016, covering a number of key points, most importantly that buyers and sellers' notes in order are kept for 30 days after completion of the order. The announcement indicates the following instructive information was compromised. The marketplace begins not older than 30 days after ID 2609452. IDs are not always sequential, as 200K messages were obtained. Conversations who did not receive a message in the last 30 days were not affected, as they were automatically purged. List of user IDs plus usernames and nothing more. Users who did not PGP encrypt their address information to the vendor will have their names and addresses or pseudonyms and drop addresses in the hands of the attacker, opening them up to potential extortion. Users with distinctive usernames that may have used elsewhere on the web risk being identified as a dark net market user and step closer towards trouble. However, compared to a typical e-commerce data breach, the FAQ markets do not use email addresses from user-generated renders. Data breach much low risk in terms of identifying and compromising site users. Whistle Alphabay suggests that attacker is financially motivated. The attacker was paid for his findings and agreed to tell us the method used to extract the information. Indeed, users were quick to speculate. If we assume that the user cipher ROO worked alone and was able to code the bot in a few days, it would be trivial for law enforcement to do that. As is always the case, anything sensitive should be encrypted because you never know what exploits the three-letter agencies know about. It's been updated. Alphabay support responded to my inquiry in indicating that the breach has also been exploited from a single attacker as they inspected the web blocks. And this has resulted in a lot of community being kind of a bit of upset, and just a lot of back and forth is going on about what to do with AlphaBane itself as a community. Beginning of February, but it's continuing on this type of conversation about what the community as a whole can do, what the community of the dark net web can do. I have a link in the article where the same author talks about this, but what marketplaces can be cited, how to use best practices, how to create better identities, using PGP, VPNs, all that stuff, and just kind of drilling it to people, using different types of cryptocurrencies, from Monero to Bitcoin to Zcash to most of the different currencies of Bitcoin, Zcash to Dash, to find better avenues to do these type of transactions through Tor without being hit or breached by a hacker. And there's been increasing efforts to try to decentralize these type of marketplaces. Right now, they are very centralized. There's servers and things of that nature. But as this, we'll be discussing using the side, we're going to talk about the aftermath or the wake of Silk Road. There's been a lot of efforts to decentralize marketplaces. Some are very clean places like OpenBazaar. And other places are not so much so, like Shadow Cash, if you will, the Shadow Cash marketplace, which I believe has changed its name recently. We'll talk about that when we talk about it on Users of the Shy. So that is it for the news. On to the rest of the episode, which is about open source. So what is open source? It's a term that often used on the network, and particularly with the discussion of cryptocurrency, but what is it? Term comes from actualopensource.com. Open source refers to something people can modify and share because the design is publicly accessible. The term originated in the contents of software development to designate a specific approach to creating computer programs. Today, however, open source designates a broad set of values, what we call the open source way. Open source projects, products, or initiatives embrace and celebrate principles of open exchange, collaborative participation, rapid prototyping, transparency, meritocracy, and community. What is open source software? Open source software is software source code that anyone can inspect, modify, and enhance. Source code is a part of the software that most computer users don't ever see. It's the code computer programmers can manipulate to change how a piece of software or program or application works. Programmers who have access to the computer program's source code can improve the program by adding features to it, fixing parts that don't always work correctly. What's the difference between open source software and other types of software? Some software has source code that only the person, team, or organization who created and maintains exclusive control over it can modify. People call this kind of software proprietary or closed source software. So this we'll get into a bit more in depth when we talk about the right to repair, particularly with John Deere and a number of different other companies where they make it impossible for people to modify, change products. There was a big thing in the early aughts about Xbox hacking. Printer cartridges kind of fall under this, on this whole proprietary thing where you're not allowed or permitted to, because you don't have a license, or technically you don't actually own the cartridge in itself, to be able to modify the particular product. For example, your MP3 files, even your digital downloads, you don't actually own your licensing to use, basically. Almost not necessarily rent per se, because they can't, as of now, I guess on Xbox you can yank a game from you, or yank an MP3 file. For example, if Kanye West released an album, Dark Man's Sleep. change and modify, and he's going to add to the album and do a continuous add-on and change songs and change the dynamics of it. A new type of art form, if you will. But what, for example, which he has changed on? There's different versions of a song called Ultra Light Beam. What if the initial version you downloaded onto your phone or your MP3 player or your desktop were all of a sudden yank for the new version and you no longer have the original version? That is something they can do lawfully, legally, because you're licensing the digital file. You don't actually own the digital file, unlike the physical disc or a physical record or a physical of anything. You only have the permission to listen, I guess you could say, and not necessarily to own. So you can't even transfer even MP3 files really to another person if you wanted to. And then this whole has to do with copyright and all this kind of nonsense, if you will, when it comes to that. But because of proprietary software, you can't necessarily fix this in your home if you want to, especially if you're somebody who's concerned about the environment, tossing computers, you need a certain way to go about tossing electronics. People don't do that. Even old TVs, you can't actually legally put in landfills any longer in other different states, because particularly the older ones, the CRT tubes inside of them. And so you have to pay a fee. So you have all this waste that is not completely broken. A lot of stuff can be repaired, and is in fact repaired if you ever go through a third-party vendor that will take your electronics. A lot of times, if they can, they will repair the phones, particularly phones, or the scrap, take the usable material like the gold and platinum and silver, all those type of electronic components, and reutilize them, especially LED screens. If they're in good enough condition, they will repair, fix, and resell those. But again, it's just a lot of waste. Instead of throwing out your old phone and upgrading, or even giving it to a third party, you can maybe repair it and utilize it, or redo something else. For example, a lot of iPhones are like 16 gigs, 64 gigs, 34 gigs. Why don't you use that as a portable hard drive? Well, technically you can do that, but you roughly literally just have a hard drive, not as a phone. Changing the operating system or removing the operating system, you literally technically can do that. So anyways, only the original authors of proprietary software can legally copy, inspect, and alter that software. In order to use proprietary software, computer users must agree, usually by signing a license to play for the first time they run the software. They will not do anything with the software that software authors have not especially permitted. Microsoft Office and Adobe Photoshop are examples of proprietary software. Open source software is different. Its authors make the source code available to others who would like to view that code, copy it, learn from it, alter it, or share it. LibreOffice, which is like it says, is an office-type system, and the GNU Image Manipulation Program are examples of open-source software. As they do with proprietary software, users must accept the terms of license, which then can use open-source software, but the legal terms of open-source license differ dramatically from those of proprietary license. Open-source license affect the way people can use, study, modify, and distribute software. In general, open source license grant computer users permission to use open software for any purpose they wish. Some open source licenses, what some people call copyleft license, stipulate that anyone who releases a modified open source program must also release the source code for that program alongside. Moreover, some open source licenses stipulate that anyone who alters and shares a program with others must also share that program's source code without charging a license fee for. By design, open source software licenses promote collaboration and sharing because they permit other people to make modifications to source code and incorporate those changes into their own projects. They encourage computer programmers to access, view, and modify open source software whenever they like, as long as they let others do the same when they share their own work. It also helps, catching bugs, catching flaws, making things much cleaner, maybe someone who has a very strong understanding of programming and functionality, but has just a shit when it comes to UI, you know, the user interface and making it pretty. Someone can come and make a program pretty, easy to use, with still retaining a function. It just looks nice. It's easy to understand and navigate. These things are very important, especially with bugs, when it comes to bugs and finding that out. It allows people to fix things and catch things before either serious issues or hardware problems happen or security flaws occur. Is open source software only important to the computer programmers? No. Open source technology and open source thinking both benefits programmers and non-programmers. Because early inventors built much of their ends of the internet itself in open source technologies like Linux operating system and Apache web server application, anyone using the internet today benefits from the open source software. Every time computer users view web pages, check email, chat with friends, stream music online, or play multiplayer video games, their computers, mobile phones, or gaming consoles connect to a global network of computers using open source software to route and transmit their data to the local devices that they have in front of them. The computers that do all this important work are typically located in a faraway place that users don't actually see or can't physically access, which is why some people call these computers remote computers. But more and more people rely on remote computers for performing tasks they might otherwise perform on local devices. For example, they may use online word processing, email management, and image editing software that they don't install on their personal computers. Instead, they simply access those programs on remote computers by using a web browser or a mobile phone application. When they do this, they engage in remote computing. Some people can remote compute cloud computing because it involves active days like storing files, sharing photos, or watching videos. Then incorporate not only local devices, but also a global network of remote computers that form an atmosphere around them. Cloud computing is an increasingly important aspect of everyday life with internet-connected devices. Some cloud and computing applications like Google Apps are proprietary. Others like OwnCloud and NextCloud are open source. Cloud computing applications can run on top of the additional software that helps them operate smoothly and efficiently. So people often say that the software running underneath cloud computing applications such as platforms for those applications. Open cloud computing platforms can be open source or closed source. OpenStack, for example, of an open source cloud computing platform. Why do people prefer using open source software? People prefer open source software to proprietary software for a number of reasons, including control. Many people prefer open source software because they have more control over the kind of software. They can examine the code, make sure it's not doing anything they don't want to do, and they can change parts of it they don't like. Users who aren't programmers also benefit from open source software because they can use the software for any purpose they wish, not merely the way someone else thinks they should. Training. Other people like open source software because it helps them become better programmers. Because open source code is publicly accessible, students can easily study it as they learn to make better software. Students can also share their work with others, inviting comment and critique as they develop their skills. When people discover mistakes in program source code, they can share those mistakes with others to help them avoid making those same mistakes themselves. Security. Some people prefer open source software because they consider it more secure and stable than proprietary software. Because anyone can view and modify open source software, someone might spot incorrect errors or issues that a programmer's original authors might have missed. And because so many programmers can work on a piece of open source software without asking for permission from original authors, they can fix, update, and grade open source software more quickly than they can proprietary software. Stability. Many users prefer open source software, proprietary software, for important long-term projects because programmers publicly distribute the source code for open source software, and users rely on the software for critical tasks can be sure the tools won't disappear or fall into disrepair if the original creators stop working on them. Additional open source software tends to both incorporate and operate according to open standards. Doesn't open source just mean something is free for charge? No. This is a common misconception about what open source implies, and the concept implications are not only economic. Open source software programs can charge money for the open source software they create or which they contribute. In some cases, because an open source license may require them to release their source code when they sell software to others, some programmers find that charging users for money for software services support rather than for the software itself is more lucrative. This way, their software remains free of charge and we make money helping others install, use, and troubleshoot. For example, when I did a review about OpenBazaar, Brian Hoffman's company, OB1, who maintains the open source code for OpenBazaar, they charge for servers to help people connect to and maintain their stores opening, as well as troubleshooting and marketing for people is one of the functions that OB1 does. This is something that they're expanding upon for people to be able to utilize OpenBazaar as a service for commerce. OB1 does all the verification and maintaining the open source code, which anyone can fork and create their own type of OpenBazaar, but they provide services, you know, the troubleshooting and helping getting these e-stores up, but also providing servers. That's how they make their money. And a number of different types of open source companies do that, like Red Hat Linux, for creating a software program for servers, help and create and generate money that way. We'll talk about Red Hat in a moment. While some open source software may be free of charge, skill in programming and troubleshooting open software can be quite valuable. Many employers specifically seek to hire programmers with expertise in working on open source software. What is open source beyond software? At opensource.com, we like to say that we're interested in the ways open source values and principles apply to the world beyond software. We like to think of open source as not only a way to develop and license computer software, but also an attitude. Approaching all aspects of life the open source way means expressing a willingness to share and collaborate with others in a way that are transparent so that others can watch and join too. Embracing failure is a means of improving and expecting and encouraging everyone to do the same. It also means committing to play an active role in improving the world, which is possible only when everyone has access to the way the world is designed. The world is full of source code, blueprints, recipes, rules that guide and shape the way we think and act. We believe that this underlying code, whatever form it should be open, accessible, and shared so that many people can have a hand in altering it for the better. Here we tell stories about the impact of open source values in all areas of life, science, education, government, manufacturing, health, law, and organizational dynamics. We're a community committed to telling others how the open source way is the best way because the love of open source is just like anything else. It's better when it's shared. And then there's guidelines and FAQs and how-to guides and tutorials. There'll be a link to the show notes to opensource.com. Not the only, but one of the better resources when it comes to open source. So why are we talking about open source? Just as the definition I just read from opensource.com talked about, one of the underlying infrastructures of the internet are from open source ideas and products and services. And what is important when you have a transparency, the ability to reshape and mold something to your liking, when you have direct ownership of a particular product. As soon as I download, for example, LibreOffice onto my Linux computer, it's actually bundled into most Linux operating OSs, particularly Ubuntu. I can modify LibreOffice if I want to. I can remove different types of programs. I can add things to it to make it better and fit and mold to what my liking of how an OS operating system should look and work on. Maybe I want to have a kind of enterprise edition, if you will. I can do that. I can change it. I can modify it. Maybe I need it to be more of graphical type of a platform for myself where there's only certain aspects of the office I'm going to utilize, and I can modify it and augment it with maybe a different type of program. There's all sorts of different things that the individuals can do. And because of that malleability, because of those ethos when it comes to open source and the transparency of being able to see the source code to test it, modify, change it, and pass it on. It allows for greater innovation. It allows for a greater transparency and flexibility with the internet. It also allows for the ability for great ideas to come forward, like things like Lens, which is a great operating system, which I spoke at the top of the show. I said it was the backbone for a lot of the Android phone devices that people use. Linux is a go-to servers for pretty much every server out there. Is a majority of them are Linux-based servers. Bitcoin, cryptocurrency, is open source. Gimp, which is a photo manipulation program out there, is open source. It allows people to have all the same features that Adobe Photoshop does, but you can do it kind of for free, modify and change and manipulate the program to your liking. And not only that, but it doesn't freeze up on you because you need to make the payments. Okay. Audacity, the software program I use to sometimes for recording on the show. I also use Oceanic, which is another open source recording platform that people can utilize for not just for podcasting, but for music as well. There's all sorts of different things and different techniques. When we spoke about Peter Thiel, we talked about making your own. We talked about open source projects of creating a self-driving car. If you want to do that, so you can links to the weekly weeks, and we talked about weekly weeks, well, it's 7, yeah, because without weekly weeks, we have to wait for the full disclosure or fallout and analysis to come out about it. Maybe into cars, maybe great cars. Last year, using the Shy, almost 2 years ago, using the Shy, talk about an episode where these guys leave. They were in North Carolina, and they modified a Jeep. They were able to stop a Jeep. They were able to manipulate a Jeep. They tested out the ability for someone to use a laptop to start a car in the city park. There was even someone who was able to hack into Telsa, and Telsa was able to have to do a software update on one of their cars a couple miles ago, where people were able to basically alter the Telsa car. So if it basically has a chip, software and electricity going through it, it's going to be hacked and manipulated. And having the ability to open source or being able to find security flaws and changes and making those changes and being able to fix things to your needs in almost immediate fashion instead of sending it to the shop or waiting for permission is a good and blessed thing, if you will. I mean, just look at all the vulnerabilities that are being announced on a daily basis when it comes to all these different security leaks, if you will, from Snowden to Chelsea Manning to the recent leaks with the Vault 7. All these different kinds of back doors that either were deliberately put there or just vulnerabilities that have been exploited by either by hackers themselves or by governments. So that's some initial information here, the opensource.org, which is open source initiative, where you can find out more about open source projects and education and nonprofits and different avenues, whether it be business or government. It's located in the show notes for you. So, a little bit about Red Hat. Red Hat is a Linux-based company that does a lot of things with Linux services, particularly they're known for their servers. On their site here, they also define what is open source, but they have a bit of a mission statement, the topic, choice and collaboration in the future of technology. Change is a constant in technology. The more we learn about open technology, we see that its core tenets, choice and collaboration, are the stable truths of modern technology. The choice of open operating systems created the first billion-dollar open-source company in collaboration and standardized and commoditized technology so it works for you and not for the vendor. That's what open enterprise technology stands for. So you can make money because think about open is already during the definition that you can make money within the open source community. And within open source, whether it be hardware or software. But you know, it takes a little time and a little effort, and it's a great benefit because you have to think about, you know, branding, quality, there's a quality product, and it is strong brand or brand, and people who are transparent and open and build this community. A lot of these open source projects have strong communities, and when you're able to successfully maintain that, you can have a good and strong, successful company and make a great living in this space. But yeah, Red Hat is one of the first companies to, in open source space, to, you know, break $1 billion in annual earnings. It smashed way past $1 billion for the fiscal year gross at $1.113 billion, up 25% year over year back in 2012. So that's just pretty amazing. And the types of services they do, they do training courses, so they teach people to be, use not only their service, but how to be in this open source world. They consult for businesses. They have all sorts of different types of products, from Linux platforms, virtual platforms, cloud computing, very big, storage, different types of industries, healthcare, telecommunication. A lot of this is from their site itself. Their mobile, the data, again, of course, they're open source. IoT, the Internet of Things, is just responsible for a lot of the different types of botnets that are out there because they're not, IoTs are not secure. No IoT device is secure. So there's that. Mind you, Red Hat was founded in 1993 with a multinational software company. So it hit $1 billion in 2012, so 20 years being an open source based company with the open source ethos. It took them 20 years to get towards $1 billion and ever growing stronger. And now, through their efforts and efforts of other companies in the similar fashion, which is open source projects that have been out there for a while, with the security climate that we have, people are embracing more and more open source type of projects, putting more efforts towards it, towards decentralizing the internet and decentralizing everything. More and more money might say is being poured into companies like Red Hat, or people are purchasing and buying their products because of the value of understanding completely 100% top to bottom what it is that they're getting, which they don't necessarily get from Google or Apple or even Facebook or type of system, any proprietary system. They have to like trust that their engineers know what they're doing because they don't have access to the source code, if you will. So another thing that's gone on within the open source space is the Linux Foundation released a business open source basic ebook. You want to know how your business can get the most from open source? This free ebook can help you. This article is by Stephen J. Vaughn Nicholas for the Linux and Open Source. It's out of CDNet. Developers know that the open source is great. Even Microsoft is now the open source bandwagon. But outside the IT department, many companies don't understand why and how open source can help their business. The Linux Foundation has an answer for this new free open source software basic ebook. So there's been efforts to try to broaden and making open source more manageable for people. And I imagine there's going to be more books of this nature coming out from institutions like the Linux Foundation and even companies like Red Hat that's making efforts to be in the open source enterprise, if you will. Here we go from Forbes. This is an article. Networking Open Source Initiative Pipeline Can Accelerate a Business. This article is by John Ferrisi. It is a More Insight Strategy Senior Enterprise Analyst for Network and Servers. targeted network has always been a double-edged sword. It delivers the stability businesses depend on to keep things running, but often lack the innovation to help businesses get ahead. More to this point, most new technology introductions were taken with skepticism and caution. Each new generation of product only seemed to lock businesses even further with traditional vendors like Cisco Systems or Juniper Networks, delivering new capabilities, but with a hook, a very expensive hook, commission, if you will, of open source. Open source solutions, on the other hand, appear to be the antithesis of proprietary network. Plenty of innovation, ability to move fast, and dramatically lower costs. What's not to love? Well, for starters, choice. Nobody likes a monopoly, but on the other hand of the spectrum, having too many choices make the evaluation and selection process nearly impossible. The business world needs a better alternative, and the open source community is listening and beginning to deliver this in a more cohesive manner. The historical problem with open source was that while better alternatives existed, the burden of integration landed on the customer or a specialized integrator who simply created a different kind of lock-in. Most businesses tend to stick with a proprietary solution because it already worked with what they had, and there was lower risk if things went wrong. IT was hesitant to open that can of worms, and business leaders weren't interested in rocking the boat. That was until the proprietary solutions limited the business ability to change or innovate, which puts a new pressure on IT to come up with a better solution. To be fair, all enterprise solutions will by default create a lock-in, as once they are deployed, they are very difficult to replace. The benefit of open source is not that it removes lock-in altogether. Instead of being wed to single vendor and single technology, one is connected to a platform / API. While the open source solution may be driven by a single organization, there are a wide range of technology choices underneath. Two large open source organizations like the Open Network Foundation and the ON.lab are merging, signaling that they understand the business need for a more fully baked open source solution instead of just projects. The idea that if we build it, it will come is stepping aside, being replaced by the realization we can build it, but if we don't make it easy and interoperable, they won't come. With the merging of these two organizations, the companies and individuals involved are now contributing to projects that are more cohesive and more commercially adaptable, enabling greater reach than before. The combined organizations are working to create an innovation pipeline to help overcome the biggest challenge with open source acceptance, the need to string all these pieces together yourself. By shifting the focus from project to a pipeline, they can establish a stack that enables multiple projects and platforms to be easily chained together, work to deliver the services that businesses need. This change to comprise of both the solution blocks, projects, and platforms, as well as the glue, the standard, and interlocking APIs that link them all together. If one envisions this like Lego blocks, the blocks themselves are the projects, and the small standardized round pegs on top are the APIs, allowing pieces to be combined into a solution. By standardizing the connections and interfaces between these blocks, more interesting and customized solutions can be built because needs to be spent on the integration. And the article continues. So big developments are becoming within the open source world. Another quick aside, Free Software Foundation. The Free Software Foundation is a nonprofit with a worldwide mission to promote computer user freedom. We defend the rights of all software users. It's a big proponent of open source. The FS provides critical infrastructure and funding for the GNU project, the foundation of the popular GNU Linux family of free operating systems and keystone of the internet. Our campaign teams create educational materials about free software and conveys the yearly LibrePlanet conference and goes toe-to-toe against powerful interests in threatening computer users' rights. Our license and compliance lab defends freely licensed software from pirate reporting and advises on licensing issues and certifies devices that respect your freedom. The LibrePlanet conference just occurred over the weekend at MIT, between March 25th through the 26th. This is an event that seeks out to educate people about free and open software, about their rights, organizing people. The theme is the roots of freedom. The conference sessions will examine the cost of free software movement, including the four freedoms, the GNU General Public License, and copyleft, and the community's focus on security and privacy protections. The four freedoms. The four essential freedoms are the freedom to run the program as you wish for the purpose, out of Freedom Zero, the freedom to study how the program works and change it so it does your computing as you wish. Freedom One, access to the source code is a precondition for this. The freedom to redistribute copies so you can help your neighbor, Freedom Two. And the freedom to distribute copies and modify versions to others is Freedom 3. By using this, you can give the whole community a chance to benefit from your changes, and access to the source code is a precondition of this. A program is free software if it gives users adequately all these freedoms, otherwise it's not free. And then the G in general public license will eventually cover open source licenses themselves and copyright licenses, particularly the common Creative Commons licenses when we talk about copyright and things of that nature. But that event occurred over the weekend, and one of the biggest, I think, news that I guess we could talk about from the event is that SecureDrop and Alexander Olivia are the 2016 Free Software Award winners. It's an event, a social benefit that awards, you know, people for their activities and the things that they do. SecureDrop received the award, which was accepted by Connor Schiffer, a senior DevOps engineer for Freedom of the Press Foundation. SecureDrop was something that was developed by a number of people, but particularly by something that Aaron Schwartz helped develop. It's a mechanism or means for journalists and sources to convey information to one another without the government or anybody being able to find out about it. There is a list of newspaper organizations out there that have this particular program, and we'll eventually go in details about SecureDrop when we talk about Schwartz, but they just received the Freedom of the Press. They just received the Freedom of the Software Award from the Liber Foundation for 2016. I mean, the Liber Planet Foundation. The SecureDrop just received an award from the Free Software Foundation, which was at the Liber Planet Conference at MIT. This year, and also Alexander Olivia, an advocate of the free software and the GNU project, Olive's impact has been felt far beyond his home in Brazil, from giving talks about the freedom software to his role as a maintainer of the Linux Liber, the full free version of the kernel Linux, leader of the Rust Latin American free software community. He started a project to reverse engineer the proprietary software used by Brazilian citizens to submit their taxes to the government, giving people their opportunity to complete this interaction almost entirely with free software, and offering inspiration and free code for those wanting to tackle the common issues elsewhere. So that's the end of the main topic about open source. We've covered the importance of different organizations and different type of companies out there and some examples. Now on to things you can build or even modify. Modders are turning the NSC Classic Edition into an all-purpose retro gaming machine. If you remember, during Christmas time, Nintendo reissued a very mini version of Nintendo that just went like hotcakes, because Nintendo doesn't know how to operate a gaming company, really. They deliberately, I think, you know, didn't create as many of these NESC classics as they wanted to. That's why they're on eBay, they were going for like twice the value of what they were. But anyways, if you're lucky enough to get your hands on the NES Classic Edition this last holiday season, you're probably impressed as I was with the quality of the emulation, so much so you wish you had a few more games, or maybe even that there was an SNES version, or your dreams coming true, kind of anyway. Since hackers found a way to rewrite the memory in the Diminutive Council about a month ago, an adventurous set of retro gaming fans have been testing the limits, first by adding a few games, then hundreds, and now by adding whole other consoles to the mix. So people are able to, the use of GitHub, are able to hack into the mini NES and just add all sorts of hundreds and hundreds of games to this particular system, which is very impressive, and just overall, I think, probably up the ante of the quality of the gaming system in general, if someone were able to get it. Pretty much be able to play anything from NES to SNES to Genesis to GBA, and even in Nintendo N64 with a classic controller, of course. Is it weird to play N64 and Genesis games on NES? I know. That's why I made an additional optional downloadable mod. So there's a link in the show notes to the article, and that will link you to the various people and organizations, or mostly organizations for people, GitHubs, that are modifying these particular consoles. And then a little bit of an article about the data that turned the world upside down on the motherboard by Hans Grashenberg and Michael Corvinus. Psychologist Michael Kalinske developed a method to analyze people in minute detail based on their Facebook activity, did a similar tool to help propel Donald Trump to victory. Two reporters from Zurich-based Das Magazine with data gathering. An earlier version of the story appeared in the Das Mag in December and basically talks about how data mining may have helped propel big data Donald Trump into victory. So that is on the motherboard. And things to support or you can buy. Outernet. Outernet offers a do-it-yourself L-band receiver kit for users at any technological level, from plug-and-play users to do-it-yourself DI kit. Build your own L-band receiver with this kit, antenna, SCR, with integrated amplifier and CHIP single-chip board computer. How Outernet works. So Outernet is a broadcast content over the satellite signals, which are turned into any digital file. The Outernet receives the broadcast fills it, creates a Wi-Fi hotspot, and users can download and view streaming. So how Outernet works. Outernet broadcasts a groundbreaking innovation in broadcasting, marrying radio broadcasts with a file delivery, transcending the format and time limitations of traditional radio TV broadcasts. Our filecast differentiates itself from traditional broadcasts by sending information into data files, so content is no longer limited to video and audio. Now, any content format can be sent over a radio signal, and receivers automatically cache these files locally so users can enjoy flexibility, on-demand access to content. With the global reach of the satellite broadcasting, the system is paving a new way to distribute access and distribute content. Outernet provides a broadcast for the usual age. The technology behind Outernet consists of the following components: a signal, an antenna, SDR, amplifier, and free software. We have made our hardware components available to everyone, and our signal is free to receive, so anyone can build a receiver and use our L-band service. Content. Outernet delivers 20 megabytes of content per day, including beautiful interactive weather data, news feeds from Voice of America, BBC World, Al Jazeera, Justice Well, Eureka Alert, Medline, World Health Organizations, Ham Radio, APRSs, and offline Wikipedia pages. Users can contribute small files to the broadcast in our file cast center. So you can contribute to the project if you choose to by sending some files. You can buy an Outernet now for $99. So a very worthwhile project, I think, especially considering that more and more satellites have been put up in there, and that there's been a strong effort out there to put satellites out in space to distribute the internet. And then here's an article on how to make your own Lampart parachute from common household materials. Technology I use. Slackchat, which is using Slackchat for the network, which is Roger Shive's space on. And Riot, which is a decentralized version of Slack. The technologies I use highlight. You can always click on these and look at them for yourself. So the manifesto of this episode is the Denton Declaration, an open data manifesto. Introduction. On May 22, 2012, at the University of North Texas, a group of technologists and librarians, scholars, and researchers University administrators and other stakeholders gathered to discuss and articulate the best practices and emerging trends in research data management. This declaration bridges the converging interests of these stakeholders and promotes collaboration, transparency, and accountability across organizations and disciplinary boundaries. Declaration. Open access research to data is critical for advancing science, scholarship, and society. Research data, when repurposed, has an active research data when repurposed has an assertive value. Publicly funded research should be publicly available for public good. Transparency in research is essential to sustaining the public trust. The validation of research data by peer community is an essential function of the responsible conduct of research. Principles. Open access to research data benefits society and facilitates decision-making for public policy. Publicly available research data helps promote a more cost-effective and efficient research environment by reducing redundancy of efforts. Access to research data ensures transparency in the deployment of public funds for research and helps safeguard public goodwill towards research. Open access to research data facilities validation of research results allows data to be improved by identifying errors and enables the reuse and analysis of legacy data using new technologies developed through advances in changing perceptions. Funding entitles should support reliable long-term access to research data as a component of research grant due to the benefits that occur from the availability of research data. Data preservation should involve sufficient identifying characteristics and descriptive information so that others besides the data producer can use and analyze the data. Data should be more available in a timely manner, neither too soon to ensure the researcher to benefit from their labor, nor too late to allow for verification results. A reasonable plan for disposition of research data should be established as part of the data management planning rather than arbitrarily claiming the need for preservation in perpetuity. Open access to research data should be a central goal of the lifecycle approach to data management, with the consideration given at each stage of the data lifecycle to which metadata, data architecture, and infrastructure are necessary to support data discoverability, accessibility, long-term stewardship. The cost of cyber infrastructure should be distributed among the stakeholders, including researchers, agencies, and institutions, in a way that supports a long-term strategy for research data acquisition, collection, preservation, and access. The Academy should adapt existing frameworks for tenure and promotion and merit-based incentives to account for the alternative forms of publication and research output, including data paper, public data sets, and digital products. Value adheres data as a standalone research output. The principle of open access should not be in conflict with the intellectual property rights of researchers, and a culture of citation and acknowledgement should be cultivated rigorously and consistently among all practitioners. Open access should not compromise the confidentiality of research subjects and comply with principles of data security defined by HIPAA, AFREPA, and other privacy guidelines. Contentions. We invite all others who support these principles of research data management to join us to make our vision of culture and open data a reality. We invite all others who support these principles of research data management to join us to make our vision of a culture of open data a reality. Join us, add your support to the principles of open data by adding your signature, organizations wishing to lend the support, and that is the manifesto for the episode, the Denton Declaration. So that's it for this episode. Thank you very much for listening, and logging off. For now, I will see you out on the streets. Thank you for listening. Please rate and review either through iTunes or Stitchers or any of the podcasting apps that you're currently using to listen to this show. Thank you, and until next time. This has been a Herosia Shine Space Odyssey Network production.